Hi, myself Dr. Divakar SK, lecturer in biology, welcomes you all for Gnana Taranga online learning classes for NEET and KCET organized by Department of Pre-University Education, Government of Karnataka. Today's session discussion of the topics are strategies for enhancement in food production, biotechnology principles and processes, biotechnology and its applications. Let's begin with the first topic, strategies for enhancement in food production. So this chapter includes the content animal husbandry, plant breeding, single cell proteins, tissue culture. So let's look into subtopics of animal husbandry. So animal husbandry, we study dairy farm management, poultry farm management, beekeeping or apiculture, fisheries. So in dairy farm management, so we study about improvement of the milk and its yield, followed by the quality. So in poultry farm management, we strategize the improvement of the production of meat and egg from poultry birds. So in beekeeping or apiculture, so we study about the various procedures in producing honey and beeswax from different species of honeybees. In fisheries, so we discuss about the catching, culturing and marketing of fishes, which includes inland fisheries, aquaculture, pisciculture, etc. So these are few species of fishes. So these fishes which are used as a source of food can be catched from marine as well as freshwater habitats. So these are the marine fishes: hilsa, pomfret, sardines, mackerel. So now with respect to improvement of animals for various types of products. So the animal breeding techniques includes inbreeding and outbreeding. So outbreeding and its types like outcrossing, crossbreeding, interspecific hybridization. So inbreeding is the technique of crossing two breeds which have common ancestors for 4 to 6 generations. So this inbreeding has advantages like elimination of harmful recessive genes, combining the beneficial traits or characters, increasing homozygosity. But continuous inbreeding results in inbreeding depression, so which results in loss of fertility as well as yield. So to overcome this inbreeding depression, so we can follow the outbreeding, so which includes outcrossing, crossbreeding, interspecific hybridization. So outcrossing involves crossing two breeds which do not have common ancestors on either side of the pedigree for 4 to 6 generations. So by doing so, we can overcome inbreeding depression. In crossbreeding, it involves crossing of two breeds of the same species to combine The traits are characters present in both the breeds. So the common example that we study in crossbreeding is the production of a crossbreed Hisar Dale by crossing Bikaneri ewe with Merino ram. So this Bikaneri ewe is the breed of Rajasthan, which is crossed with the exotic breed. So Merino ram originated in Spain and later improved in Australia and New Zealand. So the crossbreed of this is the Hisar Dale. So next, interspecific hybridization. So interspecific hybridization is crossing two different species belonging to the same genus. So an interspecific hybridization is difficult as the progeny obtained in these most of the cases are not fertile. The common example that we study for interspecific hybridization is the production of mule by crossing a male donkey with a female horse. So this mule has better trait or qualities as it can move little faster and can take the cargo in Himalayan mountain terrains. So by following these conventional methods of animal breeding, like inbreeding, outbreeding, which involves outcrossing, crossbreeding and interspecific hybridization, so even we can breed animals through controlled breeding techniques or artificial breeding techniques, which includes artificial insemination, multiple ovulation and embryo transfer technology. So even already, so these two concepts that we have discussed in the previous chapters, like reproductive health. See, artificial insemination is insertion of the semen into female reproductive tract collected from superior breeds of the bulls. So this has certain advantages. So where we can reduce the loss of sperms in a single mating, and also if any sexually transmitted diseases that are present in the breeding cattle can be prevented, and in natural mating, bringing the male and female cattle is very tedious process that can be overcome by this artificial insemination. And even the semen collected from these superior breeds of bulls can be stored for longer period through cryopreservation. And it is easy to transport to the site of breeding or for insemination process where the cattle are housed and taken care. So multiple ovulation and embryo transfer technology, which involves production of more eggs per ovulation by inducing or by giving the hormonal treatment or FSH-like activity in superior cattle. So these superior cattle produce 6 to 8 eggs per cycle, and these 6 to 8 eggs can be fertilized by artificial insemination, and the zygote or embryo that are formed are transferred to the surrogate cows. So in these surrogate cows, all the 6 to 8 embryos so will develop and can give rise to 6 to 8 progeny. So by following these two techniques, artificial insemination, multiple ovulation and embryo transfer technique, we can improve herd size in commercial cattle or in any other domesticated animals which are of commercial importance. So now we'll move on to plant breeding. So animals are not only the source of food for human population, plants are also the major source of food for human population. There are a lot of crops that are already cultivated all over the world, and there are best and improved varieties of crops that are available. Still, there is a scope for improvement of these crops through plant breeding. So, as we know, plant breeding is the genetic improvement of crop in order to create desirable plant types that are better suited for cultivation and gives better yield and disease resistant. So, now to follow this plant breeding, there are several steps, which includes collection of variability or germplasm collection. So, germplasm is the collection of all diverse alleles from all varieties of available commercial crops. So, next is evaluation and selection of the parents. Once the germplasm is collected, it has to be evaluated for the superiority of the particular parental plants. So, next, cross hybridization among the selected parents. So, once we select the superior parental plants, they have to be crossed. So, during this process, we will follow the techniques of artificial hybridization like emasculation, bagging and rebagging, if it is a bisexual flower producing plant, or only bagging and rebagging if it is a unisexual flower producing plant. So, by doing cross hybridization among the selected parents, we obtain improved trait or quality in the progeny, but there is no guarantee that this character has been combined. So, if the character has not been combined, again it has to be crossed for several generations till the desired trait or character is combined. The next step is selection and testing of superior recombinants. So, again, in selection and testing of superior recombinants with respect to the combined character that we have done in cross hybridization or breeding. So, once the superior recombinant is selected, next step is testing, release and commercialization of new cultivars. So, this is done in the research field as well as in the farmer's field for 2 to 3 generation, and it has to be compared with already available cultivars with respect to specific character or trait. So, even they can be grown in different agroclimatic zones or region. So, if it suits for more than 2 or 3 agroclimatic zones, then it can be released as a new cultivar. Now, discuss several Indian hybrid crops of high yielding variety. So, now when we compare the yield potential in India in 1963 to till date, so there is a lot of increase in the yield potential due to the introduction of semi-dwarf varieties of rice, wheat, etc. Two such semi-dwarf varieties of wheat include Sonalika and Kalyan Sona. So, these varieties are high yielding as well as disease resistance, which are introduced in all over wheat growing belt of India. So, next, semi-dwarf varieties of rice were also introduced, which includes IR8 and Thai Chung Native. So, IR8 is developed at International Rice Research Institute, Philippine, and the Thai Chung Native, which was developed in Taiwan. So, this dwarf varieties, which are high yielding as well as disease resistance. So, even these semi-dwarf varieties of rice were also used in developing Indian semi-dwarf varieties like Jaya and Ratna. So, next, some improved varieties of sugarcane. So, there are two species of sugarcane, like Saccharum barberi, which is grown in North India, but it had poor sugar content and yield. Whereas the Saccharum officinarum, grown in South India, had thicker stems and higher sugar content, but did not grow well in North India. So these two species were successfully crossed to get the cane varieties combining both the characters, which can be grown even in North India, and the yield potential can be improved. So some of the crop varieties which were developed for disease resistance. So now wheat, one of the crop variety is Himagiri, so which was developed against the resistance to leaf and stipe rust as well as hill bunt, which is a fungal resistant wheat variety. So Brassica, so which variety is Pusa Swarnim or Pusa Karan Rai, which is resistant to white rust, again a fungal species. So cauliflower, the variety is Pusa Subra, Pusa Snowball K1, which is resistant to the black rot, curl and black blight black rat. So cowpea, variety is Pusa Komal, which is resistant to bacterial blight. So chili, the variety Pusa Sadabahar, which is resistant to chili mosaic virus, tobacco mosaic virus and leaf curl. So these all disease resistant crop varieties were developed so by crossing with wild relatives or even by selecting the breeds or the varieties of crops which have disease resistance. Next, mutation breeding is an non-conventional method of breeding, so which involves inducing mutations in seeds or any other reproductive propagules, especially using the chemicals or radiations. The common radiation that we use, gamma radiation, is followed. Here, by selecting the parental plants with desirable character, so acts as a source in breeding, hence the process mutation. So once we induce mutations, so by chemical or radiations, so these mutations that have been induced sometimes may be beneficial or harmful. If they are beneficial, so we select. So for example, resistance to diseases or even high yielding. So one such example is mung bean, which is resistant to yellow mosaic virus as well as powdery mildew. Another example which is resistant to yellow mosaic virus in Bindi or Abelmascus esculentus. This was transferred from a wild species. So this resulted in the new variety of the Abelmascus esculentus or Bindi called Parbhani Kranti. So this Parbhani Kranti is developed by crossing with wild species. So not mutation breeding. So even in mutation breeding, the mung bean that is produced is also resistant to yellow mosaic virus, but the technique is different. So some of the examples of insect pest resistant crop varieties. So crop variety Brassica or rapeseed mustard, the variety is Pusa Gaurav, which is resistant to insect like aphids. So flat bean, which is variety is Pusa Sem2 and Pusa Sem3, which is resistant to jacids, aphids and fruit borers. So okra, a Bindi crop, which variety is Pusa Sawani or Pusa A4, resistant to shoot and fruit borer. So next is biofortification. So we all eat food, so which may be either balanced or non-balanced. If we do not eat balanced food, so it may result in some nutrient deficiency disorders. Hence, consumption of balanced diet is very important and essential. But everybody are not consuming because of affordability of these food crops. So biofortification is the technique of breeding crops with higher levels of vitamins, minerals, protein, and healthier fats. So when such croplands were developed, so that provides all these vitamins, minerals, and proteins which can overcome hidden hunger. So hidden hunger is the process where the human population is suffering from lot of nutrient deficiencies. So we think that we are consuming a sufficient amount of food, but this food is deficient in these mineral, nutrients, vitamins, proteins, or fats, etc. So once we incorporate such traits in the commonly consuming food crops or vegetables, etc., so we can overcome these hidden hunger. So in addition to this, the process of single cell protein, that is a large biomass of proteins produced by using single cells or those organisms which are having single cell, like chlorella, spirulina, even certain species of bacteria like Methylophilus Methylotrophus. So this bacteria is used in the production of protein biomass. Even there is a comparison with respect to a cattle of 250 kg produces 25 grams per day. The same Methylophilus Methylotrophus bacteria can produce 25 tons of biomass per day. So when it is grown under controlled conditions, hence this single cell protein so has benefit over the normal methods of protein production. So even the substrate which are used in the single cell protein includes sewage, sawdust, and also the potato waste produced in potato industries, etc. So tissue culture is another non-conventional method of producing crops. So tissue culture is growing of plants or the crops under in vitro conditions. Hence, in vitro propagation of plants is called as the tissue culture. The principle of this plant tissue culture is totipotency. So which means production of a complete plant from any part of the plant under controlled condition, or it is the capacity of any cell, tissue, or organ of a plant to generate whole plant under in vitro condition. So for this, we select any part of the plant called explant. So this explant under controlled conditions like proper nutrient medium, temperature, and various other in vitro conditions, so differentiates and produces an undifferentiated mass of tissue called as callus. So this callus again redifferentiate and produces various tissues, organs, and parts of the plant where a complete plant is produced through tissue culture. So large scale production of tissue culture plants is known as micropropagation. So these large plants that are produced through micropropagation in plant tissue culture are morphologically and genetically similar to parental plants, hence they are referred to as soma clones. So as you already know, clones, morphologically and genetically identical plants produced through asexual process. Here this is also asexual process, but we produce these plants under in vitro conditions. So somatic hybrids, so these are the hybrid plants obtained by combining two somatic cells from different species or different genus through a technique of somatic hybridization. So in somatic hybridization, So we isolate protoplasm. So that is the fluid matrix of the cell which devoid of cell wall, or any plant cell which is devoid of cell wall, is called as the protoplasm. So we isolate protoplasm from the selected plant cells, and we fuse these protoplast of different genomes or the different cells, and we select the hybrid. So in order to fuse these somatic cells, we can follow mechanical method, enzymatic method, chemical method, even electrofusion, etc. The selected hybrid, which is somatic hybrid, one example which is shown, pomato, that is the tomato protoplasm, protoplast, and the potato protoplast has been combined to produce the somatic hybrid pomato. Now, we will discuss some multiple size questions related to these strategies in food enhancement. So, the first question, the term breed refers to. So, we are studying even in animal breeding. So, breed, a group of animal not related by descent in most character, a group of animals related by descent but have almost different characters, a group of animals neither related by descent nor have similar characters, a group of animals related by descent and similar in most characters. See, breed refers to a group of animals related by descent and similar in most characters, like size, shape, configuration, etc. So hence, the correct option is a group of animals related by descent and similar in most characters. The improved and exotic breed of poultry is. So exotic breed means the breeds which have been imported or not native to its origin. So among these options, Gagas, Asil, Giriraj, and Leghorn. So Gagas, Asil, and Giriraj are indigenous breeds. So Gagas is the indigenous breed which is reared in Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka. Asil is also indigenous breed reared in Punjab, Tamil Nadu, etc. Giriraja is a cross breed produced in University of Agricultural Science in GK, VK. Hence, these three are the indigenous breeds. So, whereas Leghorn is an exotic breed, so which has been imported from other countries. Hence, Leghorn is the exotic breed. So, next question is, match the following related to the different types of animal breeding. So, outcrossing, interspecific hybridization, crossbreeding, inbreeding. See, outcrossing, so as we know, it is the mating of animals of same breed but having no common ancestors for either side of their pedigree for 4 to 6 generation. So P matches with 2. So here A and D have P 2, D also P 2. Hence among these two, either A or D. So next we select Q, interspecific hybridization. As the term itself says, interspecific, it is the crossing of two different species belonging to same genera. Hence, mating of two animals of different species. Hence, Q matches with 3. So, hence, it is the first option. So, even, so we need not to check for R4 and S1. So, still if you want to check, so R, crossbreeding, mating of closely related individuals within the same breed. So, that is fourth one, mating of animals belonging to different breeds. So, since it is a crossbreed, inbreeding, so crossing two closely related individuals within the same breed. Hence, the correct option is first one. So, next question is, mating of more closely related individuals within the same breed for 4 to 6 generation leads to. So, since it is a inbreeding process, always in inbreeding, it increases homozygosity and elimination of recessive genes. So, the objective of this inbreeding is to elimination of recessive genes and increasing homozygosity, not elimination of dominant genes or increasing heterozygosity or decreases in inbreeding depression. So inbreeding depression is actually a disadvantage. Hence, elimination of recessive gene and increased homozygosity is the correct option. So next question is, the term inbreeding depression refers to. So inbreeding depression. So inbreeding depression, so it is one of the demerit of inbreeding. So we look into the options, increased fertility and productivity. So since it is the demerit, so the inbreeding depression cannot increase fertility and productivity. So reduced fertility and productivity. So in inbreeding depression, it reduces fertility and productivity due to continuous inbreeding. So hence, the correct option is reduced fertility and productivity. So a new breed of sheep developed in Punjab by crossing of Bikaneri ewes and Merino rams. So it is a cross breed developed in Punjab by crossing Bikaneri ewe and Merino ram. So is Bekshir's Pashmina Hisardale mule. See, Bekshir is an exotic breed of sheep. Pashmina is an indigenous goat. Hisardale is a crossbreed produced in Punjab by crossing Bikaneri ewe and Merino ram. Hence, C is the right option. So, mule is an interspecific hybrid produced by crossing male donkey and female horse. So, in multiple ovulation and embryo transfer technology, the term herd size refers to. So, MOET and artificial insemination are the controlled animal breeding techniques. So, this MOET and artificial insemination is generally used to increase herd. Herd means collection or group of animals. So, hence, a large group of animals of different species. So, it can't be a different species of the same species. A number of wild animals of one species. So, generally, so we will not keep wild animals. Hence, it is also not the right option. A large number of people, a crowd or herd stranded passengers. Hence, it is not a crowd of people. A group of cattle or another domestic animal of a single kind kept together for a specific purpose. A group of cattle or sheep, goat, fowls, etc. Hence, the right option is D. Next question, the cow that is used carry embryo of genetic mother is called, the cow that is used as a carrier of embryo of genetic mother is called as carrier cow, breeding cow, transgenic cow, surrogate cow. Here, the carrier cow, so is not one, so it is not the right option. Carrier cow will not carry the embryo of the genetic mother. So, breeding cow. So, here generally the superior breeds of the cattle were selected. So, transgenic cow is developed by genetic engineering or recombinant DNA technology. So, the cow that carries the embryo of the genetic mother is called as the surrogate cow. Hence, it is also known as surrogate technology. So, which among the following are freshwater fishes? See, in fishes, the edible fishes comes from either marine habitat or freshwater habitat. The most common freshwater edible varieties. So, hilsa, sardine, catla, rohu, pomfret, mackerel, rohu, catla, common carp, D, catla, pomfret, hilsa. Here, so generally, so HMPS. So, hilsa, mackerel, pomfret, sardine, they are marine fishes which are used as a source of food. Hence, hilsa, sardine, they are marine fishes. So, catla and rohu, they are fresh water. Hence, this option is not correct. So, catla, rohu, they are fresh water. Pomfret and mackerel are not fresh water. Here, rohu, catla, common carp. So, all these three are the freshwater edible fishes. Hence, the right option is Rohu, Katla and Common Carp. So, you can remember these by the abbreviation like HMPS, and for fresh water, you can remember it as RCC, Rohu, Katla and Common Carp. So, next 10th question, the entire collection of plants or seeds having all the diverse alleles for all genes in a given crop is called sarcoplasm collection, protoplasm collection, alleloplasm collection, germplasm collection. So, sarcoplasm, as you know that it is the fluid matrix of muscle cell is called as the sarcoplasm. Hence, it is not the correct answer. Protoplasm, the fluid matrix of the cell is called as the protoplasm. Hence, it is not the right one. Alleloplasm. So, you might have known alleles, not alleloplasm. Hence, germplasm, it is the collection of diverse alleles for all genes in a given crop is called as the germplasm collection. Hence, the right answer is germplasm collection. Next, match the column with respect to crop and the corresponding disease resistant varieties. See, in the first column, the varieties of the crops and then the crop variety and the disease resistance. See, cowpea, himagiri, wheat, pusa, swarnim, chilli, pusa, komal, brassica, pusa, sadabahar. Cowpea, you can remember this with co. So, cowpea, pusa, komal. So, P matches with the third option, pusa, komal. So, here in A, B, C and D, so P is the one that has matched with 3. So, hence this is the clue in getting the right answer. See, hence the right answer is A. See, Q, wheat. So, heat, you remember it, hima, cold. So, you can relate like that, wheat, himagiri, chilli, pusa, sadabahar, brassica, pusa, swarnim. Hence, the right option is A. Next, which crop variety among the following is resistant to yellow mosaic virus? So, pusa, shubhra, parbani kranti and moong bean. See, Pusa Shubhra is a variety which is resistant to black rot. Parbani Kranti, so is resistant to yellow mosaic virus. So, moong bean is also resistant to yellow mosaic virus. Hence, Parbani Kranti and moong bean crop variety are resistant to yellow mosaic virus. So, which among the following is an example of mutation breeding? See, Pusa Swarnim resistant to white rust, Pusa Sadabahar resistant to chili mosaic virus, Pusa Komal resistant to yellow mosaic virus, moong bean resistant to yellow mosaic virus. See, mutation breeding, see, moong bean resistant to yellow mosaic virus is the crop variety produced through mutation breeding which is resistant to yellow mosaic virus. So, hence, the right option is D. So, even Parbani Kranti is also resistant to yellow mosaic virus, but the difference is it has been produced by crossing with the wild varieties of the relatives or wild varieties. So, which of the following statement is correct? So, hairy leaves of many plants are resistant to viruses. Hairy leaves of many plants are resistant to insect pest. Smooth-leaved and nectarless cotton varieties do not attract cotton ball worms. Rough leaved and nectarless cotton varieties attract leaf beetle. See, even we can develop crop varieties which are resistant to insect pest by changing morphological, anatomical as well as biochemical features. So, hairy leaves of many plants are resistant to viruses. So, it is resistant to pest. So, hairy leaves of many plants resistant to pest, not for viruses. Again, smooth-leaved and nectarless cotton varieties do not attract cotton ball worms. So, smooth-leaved and nectarless, if nectar is not there, so generally, so it is not attract any insect or pest. So, rough-leaved and nectarless cotton varieties attract leaf beetle. So, it will not attract. Hence, the option is A, 2 and 3. So, hairy leaves of many plants are resistant to insect pest, as well as smooth-leaved and nectarless cotton varieties do not attract cotton ball. So, the presence of hairy leaves so will interfere with the chewing and biting or the consumption of these leaves. Hence, the insect will not prefer. Hence, the correct option is A, that is second and 3. So, which of the following biochemical characteristics offer resistance to maize, against stem borers? So, this is an example related to biochemical modification. See, high aspartic acid nitrogen and sugar content, high aspartic acid nitrogen, low sugar content, low aspartic acid, high nitrogen and sugar content, high aspartic acid, low nitrogen and sugar content. So, hence the right option is, it is high aspartic acid with low nitrogen and sugar content, since low nitrogen and sugar is not preferred by the insect pest, hence the right option is D. Next, biofortification refers to breeding of crops with resistant to diseases, higher levels of protein, minerals and vitamins, resistant to insect pest, early maturity. So, we follow biofortification method in order to increase the nutrient qualities of the crops, not for resistant to diseases or resistant to insect pest or even for early maturity. Hence, the correct option is higher levels of protein, minerals and vitamins. Next, wheat variety Atlas 66, which has been used as a donor for improving cultivated wheat, is rich in. See, this Atlas 66 is a variety of wheat, so developed to increase some of the nutrient qualities. So, among these, iron is not which is incorporated, even not carbohydrates, even not fats, it is proteins. Hence, the right option is protein. So, which of the following species of sugarcane are crossed to produce a hybrid variety with high yield, high sugar, thick stem and ability to grow in sugarcane growing belt of North Karnataka? So, sorry, North India. So, in North India, Saccharum barberry is generally grown. In South India, Saccharum officinarum is grown. So, the breed of this Saccharum barberry or Saccharum officinarum, or the variety of sugarcane that is produced by crossing these two sugarcane varieties. So, hence it has combined both the characters with respect to yield and also adjustment to agroclimatic zones. Hence, the right option is Saccharum barberry and Saccharum officinarum. So, Sonalika and Kalyan Sona are the varieties, high yielding wheat varieties. So, which were introduced all over wheat growing belt that we have discussed even in synopsis. It is a direct question. Hence, it is wheat. So, that is why the yield production has been increased as compared to 1963 till today. So, next, IR8 and Taichung native are the semi-dwarf varieties of. So, these are the semi-dwarf varieties of rice. So, IR18 has been introduced from Philippines and Taichung native has been introduced from Taiwan. So, these are high yielding rice varieties. So, these are used as a parental croplands, and even in India, so we have produced high yielding varieties like Jaya, Padma Ratna, etc. So, next, which of the following semi-dwarf varieties of rice have been developed in India? So, even we have discussed in the previous question also. So, these are exotic varieties. IR18 and Taichung native, Sonalika and Kalyan Sona are wheat varieties. See, Protina and Shakti are biofortified maize. So, hence Jaya and Ratna are the semi-dwarf varieties of rice that have been developed in India. So, which of the following amino acids were enriched in maize hybrids through biofortification in 2000? So, methionine and tryptophan. So, methionine and tryptophan, so they are not incorporated. So, lysine and arginine. So, lysine and arginine, so these are the two amino acids generally present in histone proteins. So, lysine and tryptophan. So, lysine and tryptophan are the two amino acids that have been biofortified in the maize hybrids. So, glutamic acid and valine, so you can relate these to the sickle cell anemia disorder. So, where glutamic acid is replaced by valine by the sixth codon in the mRNA. Next, totipotency refers to. So, it is the principle of plant tissue culture. Hence, it is the capacity to generate a whole plant from any plant or X plant is the totipotency. Hence, the right answer is capacity to generate whole plant from any part of the plant. The method of producing thousands of identical plants within a short span through tissue culture is, so if we produce large scale crop plants or plants through plant tissue culture, so generally we call it as micropropagation. Hence, the right option is micropropagation. So, vegetative propagation, it occurs naturally as well as even it can be artificially carried out. Hence, it is not the right option. Macro propagation, even somatic propagation is not the right answer. The genetically identical plants obtained through tissue culture. Soma clones, somatic hybrids, protoplast clones. So, clones, as we know, that morphologically and genetically identical plants produced through asexual reproduction. So, protoplast, the fluid matrix of the cell. Somatic hybrid, the hybrids produced by protoplast fusion. So, the genetically identical plants obtained in plant tissue culture are referred to as soma clones. Hence, the right option is soma clones. Next, a scientist wants to study the viral effects on plants. Which of the following part of the plant should be excluded? So, meristem, shoot apex, ground tissue, cortex. So, meristem and shoot apex, which consists of meristematic cells which are in a state of active division. Hence, the virus cannot multiply in meristem and shoot apex. So, to study this viral effect on plant, the excluding part are ground tissue and cortex. Hence, the option is 3 and 4. Next, select the mismatched pair. So, brown rust of wheat, fungi, tobacco mosaic, virus, black rot of crucifer, bacteria. So, red rot of sugarcane, viroid. So, brown rust of wheat, so fungi. So, we have studied with respect to the varieties of wheat. So, tobacco mosaic, virus. So, black rot of crucifer, it is a bacterial disease. Red rot of sugarcane, it is actually again caused by bacteria, Xanthomonas species. So, hence it is not viroid. So, the mismatch is red rot of sugarcane, viroid, option D. Hidden hunger is used to describe a state of nutritional deficiency due to lack of essential nutrients in the diet, a state of person during hunger, a state of person during prolonged fasting, a state of person without appetite. See, hunger, hidden hunger, it doesn't mean that it is the hungry status of an individual or a state of person during prolonged fasting or a state of person without appetite. See, hidden hunger means a state of nutritional deficiency. Say, persons think that he is taking food sufficiently, but that food lack essential nutrients that results in hidden hunger. Hence, it is a state of nutritional deficiency due to lack of essential nutrients in the diet. Now, we will move on to next topic, biotechnology principles and processes. So, we go through the topics, so which includes genetic engineering techniques. So, creation of recombinant DNA, gene cloning, gene transfer. So, the first recombinant DNA was constructed by Stanley Cohen and Herbert Boyer by using Salmonella typhimorium. And the tools which we use in recombinant DNA technology includes enzymes, vectors, competent host cells and bioreactors. The common enzymes that we use in genetic engineering includes lysing enzymes, so cleaving enzymes, joining enzymes, alkaline phosphatases, synthesizing enzymes. So, lysing enzymes and cleaving enzymes, so generally lysing enzymes which will remove the cell envelope, so cleaving enzyme which cut the DNA, joining enzymes which join the cut fragments of the DNA, alkaline phosphatases are used in preventing recircularization of the plasmid or circular DNA, so and also synthesizing enzymes like DNA polymerases, TAC polymerases, etc. So, lysing enzymes, so example cellulases, chitinases, pectinases and lysozyme. So, cellulases are used for plants, chitinases for fungal cells, pectinases again for plant cells, lysozyme for bacterial cells. So, joining enzymes, so these are called ligases. So, these DNA ligases and T4 DNA ligase, which are isolated from bacteria as well as viruses. So synthesizing enzymes, synthesis of DNA strands, as we mentioned, DNA polymerase. So even to produce complementary DNA, we use reverse transcriptase. So cleaving enzyme, so exonuclease and endonucleases, which belong to a larger group of enzymes called nucleases. So these will cut the DNA. So again, restriction enzymes, commonly called as molecular scissors, which were discovered by Werner Arber. And these restriction enzymes are of three types, type 1, type 2, type 3. Among these, type 2 are most commonly used because they cut the DNA within the recognition sites. So these recognition sites are generally termed as the palindromic sequences. Some of the examples of these type 2 restriction enzyme includes ECOR1, HAE3, BAMH1, SMA, so SAL1. They are all isolated from bacteria like Escherichia coli, Haemophilus aegypticus, Bacillus amyloliquefaciens, so then Streptomyces albus, etc. So this is an example of palindromic DNA for ECOR1, so GAATTC. That is, the DNA strands which read same in forward and backward direction, or the reverse repeats, are termed as the palindromic DNA or palindromic DNA sequences. So most of the type 2 restriction enzyme cut these palindromic DNA within. So when these type 2 restriction enzyme cut the DNA, they produce two types of cut, sticky end and blunt end. So even there is a specific nomenclatural procedure for these restriction enzymes. So it is almost similar to our binomial nomenclature. So next type of tools are cloning vectors. So these are the DNA molecules that are used to transfer our gene of interest into host cells. So example of some of these vectors: Agrobacterium tumefaciens for plant, retroviruses for animals, and even the synthetically constructed vectors like PBR322, PUC16, PUC18, etc. So the common examples of these vectors: plasmids, phages, cosmids, yolk or yeast artificial chromosome, BACs, bacterial artificial chromosomes, etc. So features of cloning plasmids. See, whenever we select these plasmids, they should have certain features. So then only we can select them for cloning. So small size, if it is small size, so it can carry a large sized gene of interest. So it should have its own origin of replication. So without this origin of replication, the gene of interest that is inserted into either vector or into any cell, so it is not able to multiply. So restriction sites, either one or many, so which is recognized and cut by a specific type of restriction enzyme. So selectable marker genes, in order to select the recombinants from non-recombinants, so we use these selectable marker genes as a source. So the common ones are antibiotic markers. So high copy numbers, so this is one salient feature. So copy number refers to the multiplication of these plasmids independent of host cell. So high copy numbers means they replicate more number of times, thereby once we introduce our gene of interest into plasmid, so can increase our copy of gene of interest, thereby the product can be increased. This is an example of PBR322, so having all the features, so like cloning sites or restriction sites, origin of replication, and also two antibiotic resistant selectable markers, amphicillin and tetra. So even you can remember these selectable marker genes, tetra, so to the right. So next to the left is the amphicillin resistant gene. It has 8 cloning sites and 2 selectable markers. So next, host cells. So even the selection of this host cell is also important depending on the type of the product we need to produce. The common examples are E. coli, yeast, plant and animal cells can be used as a host cells. So E. coli is most preferred host cell in introducing many gene of interest and to obtain the product. So, but this E. coli is not naturally competent, hence we follow certain procedures to make it competent, thereby we introduce our gene of interest into E. coli through competent method. Next, so technique of introduction of recombinant DNA into host cells, so which includes a competent cell So micro injection, bioelastic or gene gun method, and electroporation. And bioreactors, so these are the large sized vessels in which the raw materials are biologically converted to specific products under controlled or optimal condition. There are several types of bioreactors that we use. The most common are bioreactors that are of stirring type. So one is so stir tank bioreactor, the other one is sparge tank bioreactors. Again, steps of recombinant DNA technology. So isolation of the genetic material. So we need to isolate the DNA from the choice organism. So again, so cutting off these DNA at specific locations to isolate our gene of interest. So again, amplification of gene of interest using polymerase chain reaction. So once we isolate the gene, so if we incorporate directly into the host or through vectors, so sometimes if any troubleshooting occurs, again we need to follow the first two steps. Hence, we increase the copy of this desired gene through polymerase chain reaction. So insertion of recombinant DNA into the host cell or organism. So through the techniques as we discussed, competent cell or microinjection, gene gun or bioelastic method or electroporation. So once we introduce our gene of interest, so we need to know whether our gene of interest has been incorporated or not. So we need to screen that for the selection of the recombinant. Hence, screening and selection of recombinants from non-recombinants. So we follow insertional inactivation method. So again, obtaining the foreign gene product. So once the recombinants have been selected, so we grow them in large scale by using bioreactors. So these products that are obtained generally are crude. So through these downstream processing, which involves purification process, so we make the finished product and it can be marketed. So again, the technique that we follow in recombinant DNA technology or genetic engineering includes gel electrophoresis. So this gel electrophoresis is a technique used for separation of DNA based on net size by applying an electric field is called as electrophoresis. So this is a diagrammatic representation of the electrophoresis, so which contain wells into which we load our DNA, which were cut by restriction enzymes, and we connect this to an electric field. So based on the size, these DNA fragments move towards the anode, so towards the positive electrode, since DNA is net negatively charged. So smaller the size, they move faster and further. Larger the size, they move slower and close to wells. So by this, we can isolate or we can separate our gene of interest through electrophoresis. So even there is a separation of proteins through polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis or PAGE. So next technique is polymerase chain reaction. So simply we can call it as in vitro replication of DNA. So since multiple copies of DNA are synthesized by this technique in vitro condition, so which involves three steps: denaturation, annealing and extension. So in natural replication, so during replication, the two strands of DNA get separated when helicase binds to origin of replication. Since it is in vitro method, so we follow denaturation. So it has to be carried out in a temperature of 90 to 94 degrees Celsius. So in this high temperature, helicase enzyme will not bind. Hence, when we use such temperature, the two strands of the DNA will separate with the breakage of hydrogen bonds. Each separated strand acts as the template. So again, in the next step, annealing. So we use a temperature of 42 to 45 degrees Celsius. We add two primers. So these primers are complementary to the template strands. So they are synthesized by using RNA primase enzymes. So after annealing, we extend or we copy these parental strands of DNA or amplify. So depending on whatever the number of copies we require. So for this, the enzyme used is TAC polymerase, so which is similar to the DNA polymerase in function, but isolated from Thermus aquaticus and hot spring bacteria. Since this extension step is also carried out above 72 degrees Celsius, our normal DNA polymerase cannot function in this temperature because most of the DNA get denatured above 60 degrees Celsius. Hence, we have isolated this TAC polymerase which function in high temperatures. So, by using this, we can amplify. So, whatever the number of fragments of DNA that are required. So, next, screening and selection of recombinants from non-recombinants. So, for this, generally we use insertional inactivation. So, as you know that, so insertional inactivation is inactivation of a selectable marker gene by introducing our gene of interest is called as insertional inactivation. So, by this technique, we can screen and select the recombinants from non-recombinants. This is the schematic or diagrammatic representation of the selection. So, here generally depending on which selectable marker gene we have inactivated, so we grow that recombinant vector or recombinant cells in the nutrient medium. So, that is especially if you have inactivated the tetracycline selectable marker gene. So, we have to grow that in ampicillin, so which act as a master plate. In this, both the recombinant and non-recombinants will grow. But we have to isolate recombinants. For that, we need to follow replica plating method. So, this cultures present in the master plates are replicated, so by growing them in tetracycline. Since we have inactivated the tetracycline, the recombinants will not grow in tetracycline medium. They grow only in ampicillin, since the ampicillin selectable marker gene has not been inactivated. So, in the replica plating method, the non-recombinant cells have been grown, but we do not have recombinants to select. But we can select these recombinants by comparing that with the master plate. So, in the master plate, so once we compare these, so these three are non-recombinant and these three are recombinants. We select these recombinants and we grow them in large scale to produce the specific product. Hence, insertional activation method is a procedure for selecting the recombinants from non-recombinants. So, even in these antibiotic resistant gene markers, it is a tedious process because we have to do master plating, replica plating and a lengthy process. So, by using some other selectable marker gene like LAGZ gene in any of the vector, so in a single plating itself, we can select the recombinants from non-recombinants. This is one such example. So, where when we inactivate the LAGZ gene in a PUC18 or some other vectors, so both the recombinants and non-recombinants will grow. So, the colonies with the blue color are non-recombinants and the white colonies are the recombinant. So, here the substrate X-gall is used. So, beta-galactosidase, as you know that LAGZ encodes for beta-galactosidase. So, if you use this X-gall substrate, so if the beta-galactosidase enzyme is present, it will convert this X-gall. If this enzyme is not there, it cannot convert. Hence, the X-gall without conversion will remain as blue. So, insertional inactivation has been done. The LAGZ enzyme is not produced. Hence, the X-gall is not converted. The colonies remain. Insertion of foreign DNA into a polylinker disrupts the lac operon. So, beta-galactosidase become non-functional and the colonies fail to turn blue but appear white. So, by this, we can select the recombinant from non-recombinants. Now, we will see few questions. So, select the incorrect statement from the following. Genetic engineering includes the technique to alter the genotype of an organism. So, hence it is a correct because in genetic engineering, we alter the genotype of the organism. So, sexual reproduction is more advantageous than asexual reproduction. Obviously, it introduces variation, it enables the organisms to adapt to the changing environmental conditions. So genetic engineering allows us to introduce desirable set of genes without the undesirable gene into the target organism. Yes. Whereas even in sexual reproduction or artificial hybridization, along with our desirable genes, undesirable genes also appear in the progeny. But in genetic engineering, only the desirable genes can be introduced. Plasmid is an autonomously replicating linear extra chromosomal DNA molecule. So generally plasmids are double-stranded self-replicating DNA molecules. It is not linear. Hence, the incorrect statement is D. Next, multiplication of alien DNA in vector or host organism requires. See, here always when we introduce our alien DNA or gene of interest into vector or a host cell, it cannot replicate on its own because always it requires an origin of a replication site either in the host or in the vector. Hence, so it requires RE site, not ROP. It is a protein of replication. It is a gene, ECOR1 and BAMH1 are the restriction enzymes. Hence, it requires origin of replication. The sequences recognized by restriction endonucleases are known as. So, restriction endonucleases are the enzymes which cut the DNA at specific sites. So, these specific sites are the recognition sequences and palindromic nucleotide sequences. So, some restriction enzyme cut the DNA within their recognition sequence. So, some the recognition sequences will be the site at which it will bind and recognizes the DNA to be cut, and it slides to the cut away from these recognition sequences. Hence, recognition sequences recognized. So, even the recognition sequences as well as palindromic sequences. So, recognition sequence, palindromic nucleotide sequences. So, that is it recognizes both recognition sequence as well as palindromic. But in palindromic, recognition and restriction sites both are same. So, restriction enzyme breaks glycosidic linkage. So, it is the bond formed between glucose molecules. So, sugar phosphate linkage, it is formed between the sugar and the phosphate in a DNA molecule. Hydrogen bond peptide linkage in protein. So, since restriction enzyme cut the DNA at sugar phosphate linkage. So, ECOR1 cut palindromic sequences which produce overhanging stretches called sticky ends on each strand. So, these are named sticky because. So, since sticky ends, so they can combine with any DNA. No, if they are complementary only, they will combine. If they are not complementary, they will not combine. They facilitate the action of enzyme DNA ligase. So, they helps in ligase. They cannot recircularize. So, they can recircularize. They form hydrogen bond with their complementary cut counterparts. So, since the sticky ends are overhanging complementary strands, they form hydrogen bonds with the complementary cut counterparts. Hence, it is the right option. So, find the correct statement. Origin of replication means origin of reverse transcription. See, RE site is not an origin of reverse transcription. It is origin of replication. Hence, it is not the correct statement. So, vector should have many recognition sites for commonly used restriction enzyme so that alien DNA can attach any one of the sites easily. So, if it has many restriction sites, if you use the restriction enzyme, so it will cut at different sites. It becomes difficult for our gene of interest to introduce. So, next, tetracycline resistant gene in PBR322 can be cleaved by PVE1 and PST1. So, these two enzymes will cleave this vector in ampicillin resistant selectable marker gene, not in tetracycline gene for this BAMH1 and SAL1. Hence, it is also not correct statement. So, some bacterial cells may have plasmid copy number vary from 15 to 100. This is one of the feature of the vector. So, some vectors have the copy number which vary from 15 to 100. Hence, it is the correct statement. Next, if alien DNA is introduced using Streptomyces albus 1 or SAL 1 in PBR322, then transformants will grow on. So, since this restriction enzyme has restriction sites, in tetracycline resistant selectable marker gene. So hence the tetracycline selectable marker gene will get inactivated. Hence the recombinants or transformants cannot grow in the nutrient medium containing tetracycline. Hence they will grow only in the nutrient medium containing ampicillin. So if alien DNA is introduced using Sal1 in PBR322, then transformants will grow on ampicillin. So next, select the incorrect statement. Selection of recombinants due to inactivation of antibiotic is a cumbersome process. So obviously, so antibiotic resistance is a tedious or lengthy process. Insertional activation of beta galactosidase produces colorless colonies. So insertion of the beta galactosidase produces colorless colonies. So it is also correct statement. Insertion of inactivation of beta galactosidase produces blue color colonies. So insertion of the beta galactosidase produces blue color colonies. So in insertional activation, the recombinant DNA is inserted within the coding sequences of beta galactosidase gene. So it is also correct. Insertional inactivation of beta galactosidase produces colorless colonies insertional activation of beta galactosidase produces blue color colonies. So because the LACZ gene is not produced, hence it produces blue color colonies because the X-gall substrate is not converted, so or not acted upon by this enzyme, hence they produce blue color colonies. Arrange the steps of recombinant DNA technology given below in a proper order. So here in RDT, isolation of DNA is the first one. So isolation of desired DNA fragment, so that is the second step. So fragmentation of recombinant DNA by restriction enzyme, so that is also the next step. So once the fragmented DNA, they have to be ligated, ligation of DNA into a vector. So transferring this recombinant DNA into host, that is transformation, either direct or vector mediated, culturing host cells in a medium at a large scale, and extraction of desired gene product. So all these steps are correctly arranged in their order, hence it should be the same order 1, 2, 3, 4, hence the option is so C. So isolation of DNA fragment, isolation of desired DNA fragment, fragmentation of the DNA by restriction enzyme. So 1, 3, 2, 4, so this is the right option, not the B. So significance of heat shock method in bacterial transformation is to facilitate. So heat shock method is used to prepare the bacterial cell into competent. So binding of DNA to the cell wall, uptake of DNA through membrane transport, uptake of DNA through transient pores in the bacterial cell wall, expression of antibiotic resistant gene. So generally we follow heat shock method to create transient pores in the bacterial cell wall, so where it can easily take up the alien DNA. Next, so restriction enzyme belong to a larger classes of enzymes, so called nucleases. So it's already blackened. So nucleases, so includes two groups called exonucleases and endonucleases. So this exonucleases cut the DNA at the termini, whereas endonucleases cut the DNA within the recognition sequences. So which of the following enzymes are responsible for restricting the growth of bacteriophage in E. coli? So it is a mechanism by which bacteria resist the growth of viruses. So by two enzymes, we call it as host restriction modification system. So for that it requires the enzyme methylase and restriction enzyme. So methylase adds the methyl group to the bacterial DNA to protect from restriction enzyme, and restriction enzyme cut the non-methylated region. So if a virus enters into a bacteria whose DNA is not methylated, is recognized by this restriction enzyme and cut it. Hence the bacteria are restricting the growth of these bacteriophages due to these two enzymes, that is 1 and 2, restriction enzyme and methylase. So DNA ligase and alkaline phosphatases are not restricting the growth. So DNA ligase joins the cut ends of the DNA. Alkaline phosphatases prevents the recircularization of the DNA. Hence it is 1 and 2. The number of cloning sites and selectable marker genes respectively in PBR322. So the clue for this is in PBR322 diagram you all learned. So tetracycline resistant gene to the right and amphicillin resistant gene to the left. So two selectable marker gene. So in this two selectable marker gene, so A and C options are there. So but four cloning sites are not there. There are 8 cloning sites. Hence the option is A. So which of the following cloning sites in PBR322 can link alien DNA into tetracycline selectable marker gene? So again, this selectable marker gene tetracycline and ampicillin. So this has BAMH1 and SAL1. This has PST1 and PVU1. Hence, to introduce our gene of interest into tetracycline selectable marker gene, we have to use BAMH1 or SAL1. Hence, the correct option is B. Next, identify the correct sequence of reactions in polymerase chain reaction. So, polymerase chain reaction is an in vitro amplification of DNA, which includes denaturation, annealing, and primer extension. So, which is carried out at specific temperature. Hence, even this PCR is also known as thermal cycler. Hence, denaturation, annealing, and primer extension. Next, identify the correct options for the labeling A, B, C, and D in the diagrammatic representation of PCR. See, denaturation, so B step is annealing and C is extension. So, in denaturation, generally to denature the double-stranded DNA to form template strand, so we carry out it at 90 to 94 degrees Celsius, hence we use heat. So, after the separation of the two strands, so next annealing, so we add two primers for the extension. So, for the extension, it requires a DNA polymerase, so it should be thermostable, hence we use TAC polymerase. And since it is a 30 cycle, so it amplifies many a times, hence amplification of the DNA. So, hence the option A, it should be heat, B, it should be annealing, and in C, it is TAC polymerase, and D, so amplify to many times. See the option, so heat, so C and D, so A option heat is there, but B, annealing, that is correct, C, TAC polymerase, and D, amplify to billion times. So, hence, here, D extension is given, so hence the C is the right option. Okay, next we'll move on to biotechnology and its application. So it includes the concept biotechnological applications in agriculture. So we can develop insect resistant plants, pest resistant plants, nematode resistant tobacco by using the technique of RNA interference mechanism. So biotechnological applications in medicine, so by producing genetically engineered insulin or genetically engineered recombinant proteins, so gene therapy. So, molecular diagnostic like PCR, enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay and autoradiography. So, some importance of transgenic animals, so concept of biopiracy and ethical issues. So, now, we look into the questions and we discuss in detail, so wherever the specific concepts are related to that. See, following are the advantages of genetically modified crops except... See, genetically modified crops includes our gene of interest for a specific character or trait. So, most of these genetically modified crops are produced either for increasing yield, resistant to diseases, adjust to different agroclimatic conditions or abiotic stress, etc. So, they reduce reliance on chemical pesticides. So, yes, if we develop pesticide resistant plants, it reduces the dependence on the chemical pesticides. Increase efficiency of mineral usage. So even it can uptake the minerals that are present in the soil for its better efficiency or better usage. So enhanced nutritional value of the food. So for example, we can develop crop plants or transgenic plants for enhanced nutritional value. One such example is golden rice, so which includes the genes that produce beta carotene that in turn is converted to vitamin A. Hence, all these three are the characters for which we produce genetically modified crops. So post harvest losses. So generally we will not produce crops by introducing gene that will reduce the yield or post harvest losses. Hence, post harvest loss is not the character that we generally incorporate in GMOs. Hence, it is the character, except this, all the three are generally used. So which of the following genetically modified crops contain BT gene? See, BT implies to the gene isolated from the soil bacterium Bacillus thuringiensis. So this bacteria produces species specific cry proteins. So they may vary from cry 1 to cry 16. So among these, some of these cry proteins encoded by cry genes, so produce these crystal proteins. So these crystal proteins produced in this bacteria are in active state. So once they enter into the insects, so they are get activated and kills the insect. So these cry proteins that produced by these cry genes belong to different groups like cry 1AC, cry 2AB, cry 1AB. So cry 1AB is specific for corn borer, cry 1AC and cry 2AB for cotton bollworm. So once we introduce these cry gene into, so any of the plants to be genetically modified to show resistance to these cotton bollworm or corn borer. So once these genes are incorporated, so this crystal protein is produced in all these genetically modified plants. So when a cotton bollworm or corn borer in its caterpillar stage, since it is a voracious feeder, once it feeds the sap of these plants, so the sap contains these crystal proteins. So they enter into the gut of these insects and create pores. So since the pH in the gut is 12, they are generally activated in that pH 12. So thereby they create transient pores in the gut that results in killing of these insects. So either cotton bollworm or corn borer in the caterpillar stage itself, thereby they cannot complete their life cycle. The incidence of these insects has been reduced. So with the development of genetically modified crop plants, so they have given, so which of the following genetically modified crops contain BT gene? So means, so those BT genes, or that is especially the cry genes that are introduced, so rice, corn, cotton, tomato, potato, soybean. So in all these crop plants, these cry genes have been introduced through genetic engineering. Hence, the option is C. Next, some strains of Bacillus thuringiensis produce proteins that kill certain insects like. So generally, insects, they belong to order Insecta, which includes class Insecta includes four order like Lepidopteran, Coleopteran, Dipteran and Hymenopteran. So most of these BT, Bacillus thuringiensis produced or crystal proteins, so they act on Lepidopterans, Coleopterans as well as Dipterans. Lepidopterans generally includes cotton bollworm, Coleopterans generally includes beetle, Dipterans generally includes flies and mosquitoes. They act on all these groups of organisms, hence Lepidopterans, Coleopterans and Dipterans. So BT toxin is insecticidal because, so it decreases the growth of the nervous system of the host. So as we already discussed with respect to these crystal proteins encoded by these cryogens. So it act only on the gut epithelium, so not on the nervous system. It makes insect unable to fly. It does not relate to its flying. It kills insect by affecting its blood flow. So all these three are incorrect. Activated taxin binds to surface of midgut epithelial cells and create pores that causes swelling and eventual death of the insect. Hence, option D is correct. So, Bt toxin is in Bt genes incorporated into cotton plants for prevention against cotton boll worm is here as Cry1AB, Cry1AC, Cry2AC, Cry2AD. See, generally, so genes are written in small letters or even italicized. So, whereas the protein encoded by them written with the same alphabets, but they are written in Roman, the first letter is capital, the remaining are small. Here, Bt genes, so that is Cry genes, Cry1AB, Cry1AC, Cry2AC, Cry2AD. So, Cry1AC and 2AB for cotton boll worm and Cry1AB for corn borer. So, here Cry1AB for maize corn borer, hence it is not the option. So, Cry1AC is there. So, Cry2AC, so not the option. Cry2AD is also not the option. Hence, the correct option is Cry1AC. So, it is active against cotton boll worm. The genes incorporated in golden rice produces. So, this golden rice is a transgenic rice variety produced by introducing the genes from daffodil and Erwinia iridivora. So, these genes will produces actually vitamin K, beta carotene, vitamin A, vitamin C. So, they produce beta carotene. So, they activate the pathways for the synthesis of beta carotene. So, once this beta carotene is produced in the rice, when we consume rice, this beta carotene in our digestive system is actually converted to vitamin A. Hence, the genes incorporated in this golden rice will not produce vitamin A, actually will produce beta carotene. Hence, the right option is beta carotene. See, RNAi mechanism may takes place in. So, this RNA interference or gene silencing or antisense technology, so is a mechanism that takes place in all eukaryotes as a defense mechanism or cellular mechanism to protect from certain pests. So, hence all eukaryotes. See, which is true about RNAi mechanism? So, it is a method of cellular defense. Yes, it is a method of cellular defense. It involves silencing of a specific mRNA due to complementary double-stranded RNA molecule. Source of complementary RNA in this process may be infection by viruses having RNA genome. So, hence all these three are the correct one. So, when viruses with RNA genome infect, so these eukaryotic cells, so they gain the ability to resist the growth of the pest due to RNA interference mechanism. So, in RNA interference mechanism, so we introduce the cDNA or complementary DNA that encodes for both sense and antisense strands of DNA. So, generally only one strand of DNA is transcribed during transcription in natural method. So, here the cDNA gene introduced into the pest resistant tobacco. So, transcribes both the strands of DNA, one is sense strand, other is antisense strand. So, these two strands of RNA that is transcribed forms the double stranded RNA. So, these two strands of RNA, either one of them is complementary to the pest mRNA, that is especially the pest which attack tobacco is Melanogaine incognita. So, these double stranded RNA are in turn broken into small pieces by an enzyme complex. So, that in turn gets separated into sense and antisense strands. So, among these two, that is the two strands of this DNA are any one of that is complementary to the PEST mRNA. So this PEST mRNA, out of the sense and antisense, so mRNA anti sense strand. So this sense strand is complementary to the mRNA of this PEST. So it will go and bind, forming double stranded mRNA. So this double stranded mRNA of the PEST cannot undergo translation. So thereby it cannot produce the specific proteins required to complete its life cycle. Hence it will die in its specific developmental stages, and the PEST plant is get protected. So since it interfere with the double stranded RNA formation through the prevention of translation, hence it is called as RNA interference or gene silencing. Silencing of the gene expression, so by interfering with the translation process, hence it is also called as the gene silencing technique. So hence the correct option for this is three. All these three methods have been involved. So in which of the following both the strands of DNA are transcribed? So since in RNA interference, so both the strands of the DNA are transcribed, hence it is the correct option. So in PCR, so it is only amplification of the DNA, so not transcription. So DNA replication is the replication of the template strand of DNA. Reverse transcription, so where, so DNA is produced from mRNA by reverse transcriptase enzyme. So hence not the reverse transcription, the correct option is RNA interference. So peptide A and peptide B chains in proinsulin and insulin are linked respectively by. So here, that is chain. So chain BC. So even if you right, so chain A, chain B, when it is cleaved, chain C is removed. So chain C, chain B, chain A. So they are connected through two peptide bonds in both the proinsulin as well as insulin. Hence the right option is 2 and 2. So some of the steps involved in the production of humulin are given below. Choose the correct sequence. So it is similar to the steps involved in recombinant DNA technology. So always first the isolation of gene of interest, so or synthesis of genes for human insulin artificially, that is through reverse transcriptase, where we produce complementary DNA or gene for insulin. Hence it is the first step, synthesis of gene for human insulin artificially. So that is fifth one. So out of these, fifth one is the first order. So hence C is the correct one. So next, sixth one, so insertion of this human insulin gene into plasmid, that is the second step. So then this is introduced into the host cell. So in the host cell, it expresses, hence culturing of recombinant E. coli in bioreactors in large scale, extraction of recombinant gene product from E. coli, its purification and marketing, hence this is the correct option. So select the incorrect pair. So ELISA, enzyme linked immunosorbent assay, hence it is correctly matched. So PCR, polymerase chain reaction, it is also correctly matched. Phenyl ketone urea, so it is also correctly matched. This is a autosomal recessive gene disorder. So ADA, which stands for adenosine deaminase, adenosine deaminase, but here it is aminase, hence it is an incorrect pair, hence the option is D. This adenosine deaminase enzyme, so is responsible for the activation of these T helper cells. So a SID patient, severe combined immunodeficiency patient, so do not produce these enzyme due to the mutation of the gene that produces this enzyme adenosine deaminase. Hence adenosine deaminase should come, not the aminase. So, permanent cure for ADA deficiency. So, this adenosine deaminase deficiency, so results in severe combined immunodeficiency. So, this can be treated by 4 methods. So, 3 are temporary and 1 is a permanent cure. So, either by bone transplantation, by infusion of genetically engineered lymphocytes, and then lymphocytes taken from the patients and introduction of the normal gene that expresses for ADA enzyme. So, here permanent cure for ADA deficiency is genetically engineered lymphocytes. So, it is again temporary. ADA gene introduced in early embryonic stages. So, generally any gene therapy method, so done in germline cells or embryonic cells, is a permanent cure. Hence, ADA gene introduced in early embryonic stage is a permanent cure for ADA deficiency. Even enzyme replacement therapy is only temporary, as well as bone marrow transplantation is also a temporary process. So, which of the following steps of gene therapy are performed in an order for a patient with ADA gene deficiency? Here, so lymphocytes are obtained from the patient. So, lymphocytes are introduced with normal ADA gene. Lymphocytes are transferred to culture dishes. Lymphocytes with normal ADA gene are then returned to patient. So, hence it is 2, 1, 2. Actually, so there is a mistake. So, this is first step, second step. Lymphocytes are obtained from the patient, 1. Lymphocytes are introduced with normal ADA gene, 2. Lymphocytes are transferred to culture dishes. So, lymphocytes with the normal ADA gene are then returned to patient. So, hence it is 1, 2, 3 and 4. Next. So, Rosie, a transgenic cow known to produce a type of milk which has all the following characteristics except. So, it is a first transgenic cow that is developed. So, that contain, so protein content 2.4 gram per liter, rich in cholesterol, has human alpha lact albumin, more balanced diet than normal milk. So, this is developed by introducing alpha lact albumin gene that produces a specific lact albumin protein. So, which is more balanced than the normal milk for the babies. So, hence lact albumin is a protein. So, protein content is 2.4 grams per liter of the milk produced by that transgenic cow, Rosie. So, hence it is not rich in cholesterol. So, it contains protein. Hence, the right option is rich in cholesterol is not the character. Next, the use of bioresources by multinational companies and other organization without proper authorization from the countries and people concerned without compensatory payment is. See here, bioethics, bioterrorism, bioweapon, biopiracy. See, bioethics is the set of rules. So, we have to follow to carry out our normal lifestyles. Hence, it is not the right option. Bioterrorism. So, inflicting or creating fear in human population by releasing some biological organism, so that affect human population. So, bioweapon, so any biological organism which is used as a weapon or device to create terrorism, so that act as the bioweapon. So, biopiracy is unauthorized or illegal usage of biological product by the multinational companies or organization or any person without proper authorization or approval is generally termed as the biopiracy. Hence, the right option is biopiracy. Okay, so that completes the discussion of a brief synopsis of the three topics as well as multiple choice questions. So, dear students, so please go through the NCERT textbook thoroughly and also the NCERT exemplar questions and various other reference books. So, I wish you all the success in your future endeavors. Thank you.